So last class I said we'll be talking about hairy root cultures. Apart from plant cell cultivations commercially for secondary metabolite production, hairy root cultures are also being used in industry. So from where do the hairy root cultures come? They were actually a disease in the plant caused by Agrobacterium rhizogenes. Now we have already studied about Agrobacterium transformations. If Agrobacterium tumefaciens infects the plant cells, then we get crown gall disease. If Agrobacterium rhizogenes infect, then we get adventitious roots, which are called as hairy roots from the point of infection because of the raw root origin locus present, RAL genes present in the tDNA. Now, there are different commercial applications of hairy root cultures. They are being tested for phytoremediation studies. They are used for secondary metabolite production, which I have already told you, where same strategies can be applied for yield and productivity enhancement. But there are limitations in the scale up of hairy root cultures where bioreactor designing plays an important role. Then production of medicinal secondary metabolites or use specially those which are endangered, then it can be done for the medicinal plants, for example, the production of high value metabolites. Then for metabolic engineering, even for heterologous expression of proteins, then it becomes a more biosynthetically and biochemically stable system because there is a stable tDNA gets integrated into the plant chromosome. But growth rate wise, hairy root cultures being organized structures as will, in comparison to plant cells, are slow because plant cells, they are dispersed, more availability of nutrients. So the specific growth rates are higher, but then because biosynthetic capability and stability is more, so people prefer hairy root cultures. Now, advantages, as we said, now they are fast growing. When we say fast growing, it means relative to the natural plant or natural root system, because in comparison to the natural root systems, there are more number of meristems present. There is extensive branching in hairy roots. So therefore, you see that the specific growth rates are higher than the normal root cultures. Then genetic stability because of the chromosomal integration. Then biochemical stability because there is organization, organized structure, so there is higher secondary metabolite yield. And moreover, because they are neoplastic in nature, so again there are no hormones required because auxin synthesizing genes are already present. So there is no requirement of hormone in the medium, so cost effective in comparison to plant cell cultures. Now the challenges in bioreactor cultivation or scale up, you can see the picture of hairy roots here. So they grow like a mesh matrix. So the problem with hairy roots is that as the working volume would increase, even from the day one, depending on the size of the inoculum, there can be gradients of nutrient limitation, especially oxygen, and also nutrients if the size of the matrix is big as it grows. Now hairy roots are self-immobilizing in nature. So the growth rate begins, the growth begins once they come together. So as the growth will happen, they will grow as single matrix, and therefore the inner core is generally found to be devoid of nutrients and gets necrotic. So hairy roots, now there is shear sensitivity. It has been observed that if stirred tank reactor configurations are used for hairy root cultures, then they break, because these roots will break, and if the breakage happens, the organism takes it as a wound created, and there will be callusing happening on the roots, thereby leading to inconsistent product formation. Then there is a requirement of support matrix because they are self-immobilizing in nature. It has been observed that the more dispersed they remain in the liquid media, the growth is hampered. So the growth does not begin. So they are required, they are needed to come together, or for it acts like a prerequisite for the growth to begin. So there is requirement for support matrix. They are highly sensitive to even the material of the support. Generally stainless steel is the material which is used in the reactors, but it depends on the species. Sometimes it is found that it is very specific and sensitive to the material of the inner parts of the reactors. So inert matrix is needed. Restriction of nutrient or oxygen delivery to the central mass of the tissue. then resistance to flow due to the interlock matrix. Now, the size of the biomass itself, like an immobilized system, is quite big. So, there will be thicker boundary layers in comparison to your gas liquid boundary layer. So, the mass transfer limitation in these systems, it is much more severe than when you are working with plant cells or microbial cells, because the cell size is small. So, the solid liquid boundary layer thickness is smaller, but here the solid liquid boundary layer limitation is higher in comparison to liquid gas. And even depending on the species on which you are working, the root itself can be very thick. So, if the root is having a thicker morphology, generally for tree species, if you compare with herbaceous species, herbs will look like this. Generally, if you will work with herbs, then you will have very fine roots, but if you are working with tree species, then you may have very brittle morphology and thick morphology. Like when we were working with Azadirachta erecta indica, initially when hairy roots were induced, it was like a taproot system. There was one single root and then branch, and the branching was also less. So, it was very difficult to do liquid culture of those roots. Growth rates were very slow. So, we had to optimize the media for, and then we applied gibberellic acid as one of the hormones, and we could clearly see the morphology completely changed to the picture like this. So, where we had seen a complete difference in the morphology, because by adding gibberellic acid, what we observed were there were n number of meristems which came out. So, more number of meristems, heavy branching, gibberellic acid is known to increase branching in root systems. So, then there was heavy branching, because of that the morphology became thin and it became easier to scale up the system, and mass transfer limitations were also reduced. So, it has to be a balancing act between the biological needs of the tissue without inducing an additional biological response, which means, like for example, wounding I said, which will include callusing in the roots. Now, the reactors for hairy root cultures, they are divided into two types, liquid phase reactors and gas phase reactors. Liquid phase reactors are generally the kind of reactors which we work with microbial fermentations or plant cell fermentations. How are the two different? In liquid phase reactors, the gas is the dispersed medium in the liquid. In gas phase reactors, the liquid is the dispersed medium in the gaseous environment. So, we will talk about the liquid phase reactors. In liquid phase reactors, the different kind of reactors which we already know, which have been used, stirred tank, bubble column, where the kind of impeller which you use has been deferred, or submerged convective flow, rotating drum and airlift reactors. I will show you the pictures. So, generally, as I said, because root cultures are self-immobilizing, they need a support. So, even in these kind of liquid phase reactors, a support is provided such that which can facilitate self-immobilization of the hairy roots. So, you can see in picture A, which is a stirred tank reactor, there is a mesh provided onto which inoculation is done, and the impeller is then and kept below the mesh such that it cannot generate large shear forces on the inoculated roots. So, what are the limitations? But in all these, so you can see the picture of rotating drum bioreactors. These are reactors which have already been used for hairy root cultures. So, there are reactors where there will be a support system, there will be a impeller for mixing, but generally you may also find that there can be two separate compartments. One can be culture compartment, the other can be your medium reservoir. So, if you want to avoid your shear forces onto the biomass, then the reservoir is aerated and mixed separately and then circulated through the culture chamber, like you can see in the picture D. So, the configuration remains the same, whatever we have studied, be it bubble column, airlift reactors, but the geometry is deferred so as to work around with the mass transfer limitations, can be for the nutrients, can be for oxygen. And because support is needed, they are self-immobilizing. So, some structures inside the same reactor configurations are provided to balance out the mass transfer and the shear forces. So the limitations which have been found with liquid phase reactors, increase root hair density increases the pressure drop across the reactor and limits mass transport. For example, if you are using this kind of a reactor, packed bed system. So then higher is the, as the biomass will start growing, there will be increased pressure drop with the increased root density. So then there will be mass transfer limitations. Similarly, even if the roots are, suppose you people have used configurations where they have used small baskets, polypropylene mesh, and they inoculate the roots onto those mesh, and then they drop the entire mesh with the inoculated roots inside the liquid medium. Now, as the roots would grow around the mesh, the branching would happen, then you can imagine that the inner core of the roots, which is there in the mesh, will not have the same oxygen availability what the outer surface would have. So these are severe mass transfer challenges in hairy root cultures. So then what can be a way to overcome this problem? You need support. The roots will grow like this. They are self-immobilizing. You cannot disperse them. So how will you improve? What strategy would you use to improve mass transfer? What can you do? These are the kind of reactors which we know, generally used. Now we know what are the challenges. So what are gas phase reactors? I said the reactors where liquid is dispersed into the gaseous medium. Can you guess? Liquid being dispersed into the gaseous medium, like for example trickle bed reactors or mist bioreactors, where the media was provided in the form of cloud and mist onto the roots, and the roots were kept on the support system. And when we did this, there was significant improvement in the growth of the roots. Now, why do you think it was, it might be helping? There's a limitation of scale up, but this was working. Hydrodynamic stress could be avoided, hyperhydricity. Roots, when completely submerged in the liquid medium, we also observed there was a lot of mucilage which was getting collected onto the root surfaces, which was inhibiting the growth of the roots. So when we had, so availability of the nutrients also doesn't mean that you keep it submerged in the liquid medium. Keeping it submerged all the time in the liquid medium was also, that we observed even in the shake flask, that there was a lot of phenolics and mucilage which was getting collected onto the root surface. So then when we read literature and we found that they are sensitive to hyperhydricity, too much of water retention onto the roots. So how to avoid that was using these mist by changing. Now you can even use trickle bed system, but there the droplet size would be greater, or you use mist, so the droplet size has been reduced. Now even in mist bioreactors, the cycle of the mist, the size of the droplet can be optimized for best results. So this is one kind of gas phase reactor system. So reactors in which liquid is the dispersed phase and gas is the continuous phase. Roots are exposed to air and liquid nutrients are either sprayed onto the roots and delivered as a mist. Now coming back to the spray bioreactors, it's not that directly we were doing everything in parallel. So one was we were trying to test the mist design. Now before that we had also got custom made small setups where we were using a nozzle, and this nozzle could create a spray of the liquid medium. And this spray, we first had made, put the roots onto the support, and beneath the support we had that spray, so that directly it does not hit the roots. It used to go up to the head plate and from there it used to fall down, the spray. But then it did not give us good results, but we saw that there was lot of water retention onto the roots. The roots became necrotic by the end of 25 days. Similarly, so then we tried that let's put the nozzle on top and spray the roots with smaller droplet size. But all these configurations didn't work, and the reason which we could decipher was probably the lot of water retention which was happening onto the roots. although we then changed the support also. We then initially the support did not have any holes, then we created holes onto the support so that the water could drain down and go back to the reservoir. But then that also did not help a lot because we could see lot of water retention onto the roots, and then the mist design came up which worked. But then scale up is an issue there. Things can work at small scale, but imagine at production scales, so quite costly. So roots are exposed to air and liquid nutrients are either sprayed onto the roots or delivered as a mist. So these are mist bioreactor designs. Now what can they do? They can eliminate oxygen deficiency in the dense root beds, and we could see that very clearly. Even when we opened up, once we harvested the reactors and we opened up the root mesh, and we could see that till the inner core we could see small branches coming out, fresh roots. So in total the biomass was one of the best in comparison to all the reactor designs which we were choosing. Low shear environment, so now there is a lower shear environment because there are no moving parts. Complete control of gases in the gaseous environment. Now this is one of the best. Now one is that it can travel till the inner core, hyperhidrosity is also removed. One of the best or advantages was that there was good gas transfer happening. Why do you think? Better mass transfer of oxygen than in the liquid, which could have been the reason for improvement. So oxygen is going to get to the roots through the mist. So if I can stretch it, then what she is trying to say is now the gas transfer is happening directly from the air to the root, and in the all the problem which we have been discussing about oxygen sparingly being soluble in the liquid, which is not the case in air. So there is better availability of oxygen for gas transfer to happen. That could have been the reason to get significant change. Then neutrino mist reactors, then trickle bed reactors, radial flow reactors, gas patch reactors. So we can see some of the designs. So this is what we also tried. So in the center, this was a mist chamber in which you can even use ultrasonic transducers where the mist was created. It then goes to the culture chamber where you have inoculated your roots, and the advantages are used. Then whatever condensate is obtained can then be recycled back to the reservoir. Then trickle bed reactors, moreover I said the quality of support or the kind of support you use also matters. We tried glass beads as support, we tried polypropylene basket or polypropylene mesh as support, we tried polyurethane foam as support, and we tried stainless steel mesh as support. And all these different kind of supports gave us different results. So the kind of material you use as a support can also become a critical factor for results. So these are some of the other reactors which have been used in literature for other organ cultures or for shoot multiplication or somatic embryos. For somatic embryo scale up, people have used balloon kind of bioreactors. Now where generally you will observe either they are used as fill and draw kind of a system to remove the phenomena of hyperhidrosity or too much of water retention, and there are cycles of water. Like in rotating drum bioreactor, the entire drum would rotate.